host country led by His Excellency, Minister Nei Shenzi, other officials of the People's Republic of China, delegates from different countries around the world, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. There is a thread called culture that weaves through time and territories, connecting people and places with the power and the strength of ideas and dreams. In the West, the word culture comes from the Latin cultura, meaning the act of developing a pattern of human behavior, an excellent taste, acquired by aesthetic discipline. In the East, it is simply the enhancement of nature, both human and divine, and it has the many names of the people it touches. When we look at the map of the world, we see the civilizations of ancient times that evolved from the river valleys of the Nile, the Euphrates, the Indus Ganges, and even the Yellow River, which stands out in isolation behind the immense barriers of the Himalayas and the plateau of Tibet. Scholars of today have established the existence of a cultural continuity between China and Europe during the Bronze Age, with certain artifacts found in Austria and southern Russia. In anthropology, we learn that even primitive societies may have produced similar and parallel ritual practices and mythologies from the Augean to China and on to Southeast Asia. These are fertility and death ceremonies and sacrifice offerings, inventions and skills, for instance, that were developed in one region could have been produced simultaneously in other distant lands with undeniable resemblance. And here we ask the question, is there a general law concerning the travel of ideas? The answer is as real then in antiquity as it is today as I speak. The movement of ideas and inventions and their transmission of culture from Asia to Europe and back to Asia flowed in a continuous stream in the first 1300 years of our era, even though very few Chinese ideas, scientific or aesthetic, made the long and difficult journey until the arrival of the Jesuits at the beginning of the 17th century. China remained isolated from European ideas. This raises another question on the conditions necessary for the transmission and acceptance of ideas, techniques, and culture. Because even with the direction of that movement from east to west until the 19th century, Europe had little to contribute to Asia, and particularly to Chinese science and technology. Ferdinand Magellan, a Portuguese who sailed under the Spanish flag, arrived in one of our islands in 1521. His chronicler, an Italian, wrote their amazement about our tribal leaders who wore silk headbands, gold earrings, necklaces, and anklets, and there was a working system of village administration. We had a form of writing, dances and music played on different natural instruments. Our ancient laws were moral codes from the ancient Maragdas and Calanchao, in a parallel manner of Plato's Republic of the West, which compels leaders not only to be good, but to be virtuous as well. For three centuries, the Spaniards converted our people to the Catholic religion, imposed taxes and forced labor for the building of churches and fortresses. The abuses of the friars and the Spanish governors were condemned in the novels of José Rizal, who was executed by musketry for inciting to rebellion. another patriot, Andres Bonifacio, tore the certificate of subservience and launched a revolution, and the first in Asia, against the colonizers. It was short-lived. Spain sold our country to the Americans for $20 million. In a treaty signed in Paris, the Americans presented to us the Western ideas of freedom, justice, and democracy, established a public school system nationwide, built roads, bridges, and government buildings, including the exploitation of our natural resources, specifically of gold. We became, during the 45 Commonwealth years of the United States rule, an Americanized country, because two of the biggest naval and Air Force military bases were in our country. We were bombed by the Japanese simultaneously with Pearl Harbor in Hawaii, and our young and experienced men fought under the United States Armed Forces of the Far East to defend the Philippines. In 1944, we were liberated from the Japanese, and our independence from the Americans was granted on July 4th of 1946. Our president, Rodrigo Roa Duterte, implemented an independent foreign policy upon his assumption into office. Our diplomatic relations with Russia and China were established in the mid-70s, and this is now being pursued aggressively with the intent to strengthen the bond of friendship with our Asian neighbors. We have crossed the ideological borders, barriers that divided the world between communism and democracy, and maintained our historical contemporary alliance with the United States of America. The West is within our gates, but Asia now walks on our streets. Our country is an archipelago, a body of water of 7,107 islands. We have a national language, but English is our lingua franca for communication. Because of half a century of American education, by the curious twist of colonial fate, we are more Western than Asian, and our cultural heritage is a reconstruction still in progress while coming to terms with our national identity. The other countries in our region, including the member countries of the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, Brunei, Cambodia, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, Thailand, Singapore, and Vietnam, can likewise trace historical periods of colonization from the Western powers, except for Japan's East Asia conquest in the last World War and that of Korea's self-preservation as a divided country. No other country in Asia has gone out of its territory to conquer another. Today, we are all privileged to speak before this forum and address our world as the Republic of Humankind. We may have episodes of Western domination over our land, natural resources, and for many centuries even, but our people know deep in our hearts, as I began this speech, that the thread of culture weaves through time and territories, connecting people and places, the power of ideas and dreams. By tracing the ancient roads of history and using them in the connectivity of our cultures and creeds, we have only to arrive at the common threshold where both the oldest and the newest civilizations of Asia converge for the commonality of humankind. The dialogue between the East and the West has moved to a different level. We now approach the West with a refreshed sense of mutuality of our cultures. We have had an exchange of ideas and technologies, which has produced other profound changes, both material and spiritual. It may not always be a record of mutual understanding. We do not intend to make excuses for the past, neither would we obliterate it. It is now the foundation step towards the door we open to the world. As the Silk Road was, for many centuries in antiquity, the economic highway of the places traversed by the overland and maritime routes, the One Belt, One Road program is now the dialectical relationship between the economic and civilization development in Asia. The narratives of the interchange of ideas were also the stories of the cultures carried in the packs of products and goods that were bartered along the way. Jet planes, motion pictures, television, the internet and its technological applications, even the printed business journals, do not automatically extend the range of mind nor translate to cultural contents. Today, the area of misinformation and the number of the misinformed has enormously extended. The increased affluence of the West and the desire to appear cultured has resulted in a contrived presentation of reality. Mass communication may produce an awareness of other cultures, but it is an awareness that is covered by prejudice, the prejudice of the dominant role the West has played in Asia for the past two centuries. The struggle for independence led Asians to the assumption that their sufferance emerged from the intrusion of the West. The attack on Western materialism as contrasted with Eastern wisdom do not always translate to the rigidness of the Asian social order. But this is not cultural arrogance, nor the manner by which Asians could cling fanatically to their idealized beliefs. We are fortunate to live at a time when the knowledge of our world and all other worlds preceding it are immense. The West holds the superiority of its own technology and science, creating a new universal culture. And although scientific inventions may be, in the early times, products of Western endeavors, there were significant antecedents from Asia as well. We can, as we should, objectively observe any particular culture in the past as part of the march of history.